is issued, a property line adjustment is approved by the city assessor before the building permit is issued, and all of the requirements that the city engineer listed in his report would also be complied with as well. So, get that, Rebecca?
Got it.
All right, so we have a motion, we have support. Is there any further discussion on that?
Defer the sidewalk, but if you say anything about...
To defer the parking places, and then make a recommendation to city council for the waiver of the sidewalk installation.
But don't we want to have it so that they, in the future, put it in?
It's a city council decision. We're just making a recommendation that they waive it for now, but the city council could tell, how they want to work that. We don't say that
correct. Well, shouldn't we word it that we want to have it so that in the future that it's required that once the sidewalk is coming that way, that they also agree to putting it in?
That would probably be my recommendation to the city council, which I will be making at some point.
Okay.
I will lend my second.
If I may, Mr. Owens, I didn't hear anything regarding the outdoor dining area or the dumpster.
Yes, because Mr. Johnson said we could just remove that because that's already in the site plan.
Gotcha. Okay. Just want to make sure I'm saying.
For the HIC use around the dining area and the dumpster where it's listed on the site plan. So I struck those from his. All right, so I will, if you allow me, then I will amend my motion on that item, point four under there, that we're recommending to the city council the approval of a waiver from the sidewalk installation along White Creek Avenue with the contingency for it to go back for them to put in later if so required.
Okay. Yeah, I amend my second.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion on that? All right. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Opposed, no. All right. Motion carries.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. And anybody need a cup of coffee before we go on? Went to the Zoning Board of Appeals to ask for some changes there, and that variance their variance request was denied, and so which then puts any site plan considerations for O'Reilly's really, we don't have anything to consider at this point. So I make a motion that we just table this until we have enough information to be able to make a decision. Any further discussion? Okay. All in favor of tabling, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right, let's return to the B ordinance. Ms. Womack, I'd like to, in your report, what you laid out that we're going to be addressing, but why don't you recap that again for the planning commissioners?
Sure. So, this body did make a recommendation to the city council last time, and partially based on my advice, they sent it back to you guys for further discussion. And I did receive an email from one of the planning commission members asking questions about this particular individual who's been coming to our planning commission meetings. And I just want to point out that I'm not discussing that individual at this point. At this point, we are making a recommendation to City Council about the law itself, the policy behind the law. And so I did forward you guys that email, and I did bring some of the questions here into my report. And so the recommendation from the Best two hives for any size piece of property. Now, that is, you know, the recommendation writ large from, you know, the state body. But of course, we don't have to follow those guidelines. We can adapt them to our local use. And as I indicated in the email, the typical size lot here in the city is 8,712 square feet. But we do have pieces of property that are significantly smaller than that. I did find one that was about 5,000 square feet. I don't have it up in front of me right now, but there is a minimum size also for how small a piece of property can technically get. So one of the questions I think I'd like to have answered is this body comfortable recommending that two be the minimum number of hives permitted on any lot, or would they like it reduced to one? And is there a square footage that this body feels comfortable recommending be the minimum size, if any? You certainly are under no obligation to recommend a minimum size, but if you have a 5,000 square foot piece of property, which is very small, are you comfortable then having two hives on that piece of property?
I'm making it with the name of the one.
Say it again, didn't they?
Well, yeah, they said it would be minimum of two on there. I'd say minimum of one if you're going to have one. Not, because two might be excessive for something small out.
Minimum or maximum?
Well, he's saying minimum.
I'm sorry. I guess it would be the maximum for a particular size lot.
So no more than two.
Well, currently, you're allowed up to two. I'm going to pull my material real quick. So keep no more than total of two hives on real property less than 10,890 square feet. So that would encompass the overwhelming majority of lots in the city, as our regular lot is 8,700 square feet. And then, of course, it goes up from there, four hives, less than 21,000 square feet, six hives, less than 43, eight hives, 43, et cetera. So, again, my question for you guys is one hive an appropriate starting place as opposed to two hives? And if so, what square footage do you think is appropriate for one hive versus two hives?
You're saying that these numbers that you've got are...
So these are the numbers that were part of the best practices that was the agricultural best practices. I forget the GAMP recommendation. But of course, we can adapt that to the city. If we feel that it's not appropriate to have, you know, that many bees on a small piece of property, we can say you shall have no more than one hive on any property less than 8,700 square feet. So that would make a standard size lot be able to have two, but a lot that's less than the standard size would only be able to have one.
I'm fine with your 8,700 square foot, you know, the thing you're throwing out there, but I would want to post a question. It's not like the bees are actually going to live on those 6,000 square feet and not leave. For the most part, the bees are leaving that area.
Sure.
They're actually living in just a couple square feet. So the size of the property itself doesn't have a whole lot to do with where the bees decide to hang out, so that's what I would say. I'm curious, are you concerned that there's going to be a population density where a bunch of lots of 6,000 square feet are going to put bees right next to each other?
Well, I should point out, I don't have any concerns.
Maybe I misspoke, but I'm just trying to figure out what we're defining here. Are we defining the space that the bees are going to populate in general, or are we defining the space that they live in?
I think the discussion is, are we going to allow somebody to have 20,000 bees or 40,000 bees? So you're essentially doubling the number of bees on a small piece of property by allowing two hives.
Right. And in my answer to that is, we'll have 20,000 bees or 40,000 bees within the flight area of these bees, because they're not going to spend that much time on the actual property except at night.
So
So whether we add 20 or 40,000, it really is not going to have a huge difference on that particular piece of property during the day when they're actually applying.
But it will in the neighborhood. So wherever they go to find flowers.
As determined by the density of flowers in the neighborhood, yeah. Because they're not going to hang around where there's not flowers. Which actually is the larger point. The where the bees are going to be is not necessarily where the beehive is, it's where the flowers are. And we're not debating how many flowers we put into the yard that attract bees.
I've noticed that honeybees, we used to have some, an invasive species, and it was banned from Japanese knotweed. And the honeybees would just cover those things. We could walk out there and do whatever we wanted to, and the bees never bothered us at all. I think a lot of times people get bees mixed up with hornets and so forth.
I thought bees and ground bees are not too far off the size for honeybees.
I guess my thought is if these are what have been best practices, there's a reason why they've been best practices. They've probably been tested and I don't know that. Right. We're not really like experts to.
No, we're not.
To say how many bees.
You may not be experts on bees, but you should be at least tangentially considered experts on the local requirements and zoning requirements.
That's what I said. That's what gets you helpful.
So the amps, is that a specifically defined guideline, or does that morph and change from 5 years to 5 years?
I don't know, because this issue's only come up in the last couple months for me.
I just want to make sure we're specifically using something, not something that can change, and now our ordinance or whatever changes. So
they do change those amps every year. They could change every year. They look at them every year, and they may change them or they may not change them, but they're subject to change every year.
So our thing is subject to change. I just want to make sure we specifically say we're going to use the Michigan State Extension guideline or whatever. Now everybody knows exactly what that is and whatever, where I don't know if everybody knows exactly what the answer is.
Yeah, so in the ordinance, the way it's written, there are specific requirements in the ordinance itself, but I think it also says must follow the requirements of the GAMP.
Yeah, in section 5.
So are you suggesting I put GAMP of 2016, something to that effect.
Okay, just so it's a little more specific.
Yeah, because we do that for the International Property Maintenance Code and stuff like that. So, thank you. I appreciate that.
Lisa?
This draft ordinance, it says something about a two-year trial period, experimental basis for 2 years. Is that?
That was language that I had from, I think it's the Grand Rapids chicken ordinance. And I think the point was, if it becomes an obnoxious problem, that, you know, that there should be no expectation to be able to have chickens, or in this case, bees, for longer than 2 years. And of course, if it doesn't become a problem, then it can simply be, you know, considered to be ongoing and remove the two-year trial period.
So is that the thing where, like, it's got a sundown, sunset date on it, and if the city council doesn't renew it, then it just expires?
Correct. And, of course, you could recommend or tell me that you don't like it, and I could remove it as part of the draft. So
I think that's a good idea, I think.
I really don't think hordes of people are going to come in here and want to hear his bees.
It
doesn't matter if it's one or a horde. It's more, I think, aimed at we have these requirements, and if we have 10 people come in and get a permit, and 10 people decide, well, I just don't feel like following the rules, you know, you're almost saying then, you know, we shouldn't allow it because people just don't follow the rules. So after 2 years, you kind of review what's happened, see how it's turning out in the city. That way, you're not saying to all the people who had an expectation, well, I can have bees for 30 years now. You say, hey, look, it said 2 years. You knew ahead of time that it was a two-year, you know, period. And, of course, if it's not a problem, then it just keeps going on. So that's the reason behind that. So I think I put in my report also, you know, whether to should these be excluded from 200 feet of a school or daycare? Of course, those are just examples, but can the planning commission think of anything that should prevent you as a homeowner from having it on your property? What if, you know, the next door neighbor kid has a kid who's allergic to bees? And of course, part of the reason that there's been a recommendation to the planning commission to review these permits is it should be part of the public hearing that would accompany giving out a permit. And that's why you would want that, you know, the next door neighbor to come in and say, if my kid gets stung by a bee, he'll die. So I don't know if it's necessarily something you have to write into the ordinance. That should be, at least the way I've written it currently, should be something that would come out as part of the public hearing on the permit. But of course, I've got 9 smart individuals up there, so if you guys have any other thoughts or suggestions on that, I'd like to hear them.
I think that you've only got 8 from all that, but close enough.
You count for 2.
Under section 715, which is a person keeping the honeybees shall follow the generally accepted agriculture and management practices for beekeeping, apiary management to the best of their ability. Is there a way that we can put a dash in there and say, including but not limited to feeding sufficient honey for the bees to feed onto the land? Because we've already determined the reason why we're making this ordinance is because bees are animals. Now the bees create that honey for them to feed on through the winter. Their systems are not really set up for people that feed their bees fructose or high fructose corn syrup. And so for them to rob that hive all the way in and fill that back up with honey, or with some sort of syrup, that is no different than a puppy dog. Because they're simply using the bees just for the honey, they're not really caring for the bees. There are some apiaries that they see no problem with that, and I know it's not something that we can police, no more than they police the 3-hour parking and some of these other things, but when somebody sees that, they'll question why. And if their buddy feeds them corn syrup, they may question why is there a thing about making sure they get their own honey. It's a humane thing. I know we've had the puppy mill thing come up before. If our community is worried about the puppy mills, we should be worried about the bee mills. If we're classifying the bees as an animal, and that's the reason why we're making this ordinance, correct?
I think that's the reason why we're making this ordinance. We're making this ordinance for a public safety issue,
but
to determine whether or not people are allowed to do this on their property. And not because we're making a public statement that our ponds are protected at all costs. We kill mosquitoes that are in the same class of animals, and we don't offer them that level of protection. It is certainly beyond a scope of
right. I know that this is not about his case, but in determination why he had issues with having that on there, because he did not have a permit to have the animals on his property. Was there something not in that, Mike?
I'm sorry? Yep, he had bees on his property. Specifically says in our ordinances that you shall keep no animals except for dogs, cats, canaries, and other common household pets.
When did a bee become an animal?
Bees are animals. I don't know why this is such a hard concept to people.
I thought they were insects.
Insects are animals.
Of course they're animals.
And so this is my point. If we're worried about animal health in general, animals are animals, the same as people are people.
A mosquito can't pollinate anything. They don't do any good at all. They just kill them.
They can't pollinate mosquitoes.
They don't kill bees.
I'm not publicly getting in a position where I'm suggesting that they're abuse. I'm saying that this is beyond the scope of what we need to go on this particular ordinance. It's not something that I'm going to burden a citizen with about how exactly they're treating their bees. If they treat their bees poorly, then they won't have bees anymore. That's their choice. I'm not that concerned about burdening them anymore.
Does anyone else want to recommend that I put that language in there?
I will.
course, I can certainly present language, and this body can, because this will be coming back to you again. This body can recommend to add that language or not, or recommend that language to the city council or not. So, based on the fact that I have two people who at least would like to see that language, I will draft some.
We really need more time to research this whole fee thing.
Which is why it's going to come back to you.
Yes.
Do you research the effect that the quarantine has on the bees? And that's why, a portion of the reason why we have a less number of them that are returning to the hives.
It sounds like some information that maybe Mr. Hopkins should present. All right.
Yes, sir. Some other concerns from my perspective. The hives and the lot size is a concern to me. The fact that you have in here no closer than 10 feet from property line is a concern to me. And that's, I mean, that's not far from my property line. I have bees up close to my house. So I don't really like that as an option.
Do you address that way because the accessory building ordinance only allows 10 feet? And so I believe the current setup is inside a garage. And I think Mr. Conley's point is these bees don't stay on the property regardless of whether it's 10 or 15 feet.
Okay.
That's the way it was written.
And then it talks about fencing here, but only if it's a certain square feet or feet from lot. And the fencing is just, that's number 8. That's abutting a property line. What about fencing around the property? To me, this, visually, I would think of this as, okay, if I'm trying to sell my house and a neighbor has this on their house, that's a concern to me. I think it's off my property value. I wouldn't want to be trying to sell my house when there's a beehive right next to my house.
This language came straight out of the GAMP. Certainly, if you have support on the Planning Commission, I could write it so that they require a 6-foot privacy fence to have this, or something to that effect.
That would be something I would be interested in.
So
they're
going to fly
over
the fence. Yeah,
visually. Visually is one thing, but also the GAMPs recommend a barrier that the bees would have to fly over. Just based on the reading I have, they go up to 6 feet and they stay at 6 feet, or 10 feet, or whatever it is. But unfortunately, we are only allowed to do 6 feet based on the fence ordinance. So it redirects their flight path, which then makes them go over your neighbor's yard. I think that's the point. And of course, you should note that a privacy fence is a significant expense, several thousand dollars. Mm-hmm. Does anyone else?
I just have a question. What does it mean to work bees?
Depending on the hive. Like, you know, you see the people in the suits, they get in, they pull the cone out or the honey out.
Does anyone else on council think I need to write in language? To require a privacy fence?
I think it's not going to do anything other than the person's eyeball site.
Yeah, but I go back to selling that property. Yeah. I wouldn't want to go buy a house next to somebody that has a beehive. Absolutely. Nobody. I would.
Okay. I'll grab some language and I'll bring that back to you.
Coming with small kids, and I wouldn't want to buy a house next to somebody that has it. I mean, just visually seeing that. Desire to have a house like this, so that makes my property value go down. In my opinion,
I don't think it affects your property value.
It makes selling it harder. Maybe not property, it makes selling it harder, which means it could be harder to get a good value on your house. Kill all the flowers.
Okay, the only other thing I listed for this go around is there anything else in the ordinance that you see changed? Obviously, this is a good example because it wasn't really listed in there, but spelling errors, anything like that? Working the bees?
Why are you looking at me?
In your section, it's called keeping of honey bees. Okay.
You have all the way to the end, you have 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, and then it goes 15 again.
So guess that should have been 19.
But then that point also, you when you were talking to Mr. Laws earlier, you said, you know, about putting in the GAMPS according to year, whatever, you know, you probably need that in that point as well. Since you had earlier in at number 5.
Yep, thank you.
You could have come in there about ducks, too.
Do I? You know, I actually did a controlled search of ducks and chickens, because that's how I kind of...
There was one sentence in there, so...
We've seen a bee.
Anything about chickens?
It made reference to 3 animals, chickens, ducks, and...
Chickens, ducks, and bees, yeah, okay.
No, it said just because we're allowing you to have bees doesn't mean you get to have ducks and everything else.
Okay.
I didn't know if that needed to be in there.
Possibly. I will look for that. Thank you. Anything else? Anybody? I do have another question in here, and that is there any reason why the Planning Commission members think that Planning Commission members would not be able to deliberate and approve of a beekeeping permit? Now, the reason that I drafted it in such a way is that the Planning Commission would look at this is, of course, and you guys are supposed to be the authority on the zoning and land use here in the city, but also there is some case law that suggests that you cannot allow for an next-door neighbor to hold a veto authority over your own land use in your property. And so there are other cities in the local community whose bee ordinances, I believe, are already out of date based on that case law, that if the next-door neighbor says, well, I don't want to have bees, now that ordinance is illegal. So the way it's been drafted is you guys would be able to take into the totality of circumstances, including something like the neighbor coming in and saying, well, I'll die if I get stung by a bee, whether you think that's an important reason to approve or deny based on all the things you hear. So is there anything that you guys can think of that would prevent you from deliberating and approving of a beekeeping permit? Well, so I'm seeing a bunch of blank stares, so maybe think on that. And that is something that this will come back to you after I've drafted some additional language, and you guys can review it in a future date. Of course, I have told the code enforcement officer not to effectuate the city's animal ordinance at this time until we have this issue resolved. So we will continue to work on it because I want to get this right. And I guess with that, I will draft some language and bring it to you in the future.
Number 3, Michael.
Sorry?
Number 3 is the one that has the language about the ducks and stuff.
Number 3, what?
The person who keeps or houses honeybees on his property shall comply with all the following requirements.
Yeah, there's lots of number
3.
Applicability of the property maintenance code. Well, that's
keeping
right.
Of honeybees.
Sorry.
That's what I made it. Keeping of honeybees, number 3?
Yeah.
The principal use of a person's property is a single family dwelling. Yeah. No person shall have chickens or ducks to be kept on a lot containing a multiple family dwelling. So I don't know if you want to say that's the word bees or just straight them out.
I will look at the language and correct it. Thank you. With that, Mr. Chair, I think we're ready to move on.
Okay. Right. So master plan, as Mr. Womack said, unless you have any objections to what's been presented to us, then we're going to consider that the final draft and start to use that. So, are there any things in there that you see that need to be addressed?
I already picked it up.
So, did you change the city staff person there, or no?
City staff person?
Yeah, under right where it says acknowledgements.
I didn't change any of that because, of course, I wasn't the primary person to get started with this. Yeah. I'll put mine on the next one.
Well, I don't know if it went by when you started or when you approved or how that goes.
No, I just did all the work. I don't get any credit.
question about that. Did the planning commission already make a motion to adopt the master plan?
Yeah, this has been adopted. The only thing we were working on is some of the pictures and some minor changes. So those have been made.
So the date of adoption would be the date of adoption.
Yeah. All right, so that's good. All right, move to number 11 on our agenda, correspondence, ZBA variance request. That was the one from the...
Yep, correct.
Shared that with you. Okay. Sign standards ordinance amendment passed by City Council. Anything we need to do on that again, or...
No, I think we just want to let you know that your recommendation to pass was considered and City Council approved.
Okay. Lighting on Main Street, we're not talking about Main Street City Planners, right?
No, although their office is very nice and maybe they'll put some holiday lights on.
That's a good catch there.
Yeah. Plus Main Street, not Main Street together, so.
Right, yeah. All right.
DEA and Chamber are asking the City Council to agree to pay for the lighting for the, all the trees along Main Street to do that again.
Good.
The DEA and Chamber is raising funds from sponsors to pay for the lighting. So.
Okay, good. Mr. Womack, you got anything else for us?
No, I mean, I'm happy that you guys are a working body. Obviously, some of the zoning ordinances are out of date and getting in the way of business development. It's been one of my main goals here to make the city more efficient and easier to work with. And we're going to be doing that for the next couple months. Last year, I said I was hoping the winter months would be slower and I could dive into some of the things, and it just never happened. So I will again say I would like to have some slower months ahead of us and we can dive into some of the stuff. But of course, busy is good. Mm-hmm. It just means we got more economic development. So, okay. So thank you, everybody.
Any questions? Yeah.
The PUD for the downtown, we briefly talked about that this last week.
Yeah, sure. So based on my discussions with the city planner, it appears that we did pass a PUD ordinance, but it doesn't appear to have actually been applied to anything. So the ordinance says, you know, you can have a PUD, but it doesn't say shall be applied to the B2 district. It doesn't say B3 district. It doesn't say HC district. So that appears to be a minor change, and I could obviously draft an ordinance that would allow that. Mr. Johnson, do you have anything to add?
Well, I would agree with the city manager that it is an ordinance waiting for somebody to request a rezoning to PUD as an overlay zone. Your PUD is an overlay on top of what's there, and then all the regulations that are in the B2 zone, for instance, if somebody puts a PUD on top of that through the normal rezoning process, then they would be allowed to have all the B2 uses plus some other uses in the ordinance and maybe some modification of the regulations. But somebody actually has to come in and ask for it.
So it's not something that would require ordinance change?
No, somebody can come and ask, no. Unless you want to apply it, but there's no reason to apply it to an existing parcel because they're perfectly content the way they are. You would be creating mischief if you did that.
So they people have got to know there's a PUD before they can request it, right?
Well, they have the option to come in and ask for this PUD to overlay on top of their existing zoning.
Because like with
we created two PUDs
in the past couple of years. One was for the library project and all that. Then the other one was for the downtown. The one for the downtown, that was the one I was brought up last planning commission meeting because it would play an effect for the Canary's property.
Right. Is there a record of that rezoning and an adoption date and an ordinance that created that?
There should be.
Well, we spent months on that.
And that's what I think we're saying, at least based on what
calendar to remember to look that up, because I'm sure I still got the maps where we took a picture of the whole town and put which buildings we thought within a 20-year period may be gone.
Is it this map right here?
Yeah.
Yes. I have that map, but it doesn't tell me anything.
It goes along with that ordinance that she sent us.
There's no
weapon. You gotta use your crystal ball.
Well, yeah, I mean, here's the thing. Language matters, and so you may have discussed it, you may have had workshops on it, you may have come up with a map, but until I see it written down in an ordinance, it doesn't actually apply to it.
Because that was a bonus in my council, too.
Yeah.
And I was gonna say, we send it back to council.
That's why I appreciate you.
Ooh, council sent it back.
Writing,
oh, they sent it back. When we were having the debate. Yeah, I mean, I read what happened by council, and I saw nothing in there that. Okay, that's where it ended up.
You know, it went back and forth, and it was still in our court after the 14-foot ceilings and stuff. So would this body like a, I guess, a memo recommendation from the city planner and city manager about how to proceed, or what the recommended course of action might be?
Yeah, and if we could find that, find the minutes when that was adopted, may give us a clue as to what was actually intended or what was actually adopted.
Well, I'll tell you where the discussion started. Maybe that could help you look for it. Was when the Cedar Springs Brewing Company was coming in because of you know, they were requesting some things that were very cultural to a microbrewery. Especially one, you know, it's kind of got European flavors, like with their flags out front. And so we had to word that a certain way to, in order to allow them to have the number of flags that they needed to, you know, for their business. And then that's when we started, that's when we started the idea of, like, saying we need something that gives us some flexibility with some businesses that are going to come in and be B2 district. So, if you go back to, like, about the, you know, if you can find where the, you know, like the date that we approved the site plan for the Cedar Springs Brewing Company, shortly after that, like within the next couple months after that, we started our discussions.
Okay, we'll look for the minutes, and we'll have to bring any recommendations as well.
They were changed in the PUD. That's what they approved.
Yes. Yep.
Which I thought put that in.
Well, but like, really quick, we sent it to City Council, and City Council had some concerns, they sent it back to us, and I don't think we ever finalized that.
It was kind of around the time of
so,
that was my point the other day. I didn't think we ever finished the process, but it died somewhere in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that, the PD ordinance that I was given, ordinance number 190, was adopted in effective September 24, 2015, so exactly 2 years ago. The ordinance itself, the language that would allow somebody to come in and ask for a PUD overlay zone, is in effect.
Right.
But the map that I have here doesn't tell me anything.
Yeah, well, we never finished that part of that.
Yeah, yeah. So nothing, as far as I can tell, nothing is zoned PUD in the downtown area.
Right. I thought that map was supposed to be part of that.
Right, the PUD is supposed to be like an overlay over the B2, the whole B2 zone.
Well, and that's certainly something we can do in the future. But it appears to have never actually been done.
Okay.
And just based on what Mr. Johnson's saying, it sounds like there might be some misgivings about doing that. So we'll present, I guess, our thoughts on it, and we can proceed further if you guys would like.
Yes.
The PUD zone is actually in effect, and the micro canner business that we approved last month didn't follow this PUD procedure at all. In fact, this procedure is much more complicated than the process that we went through with micro canner.
This PUD was supposed to make it certainly easier.
Easier for us to make it easier for the businesses to be a little bit different.
If I was going to write this, I wouldn't write it this way. If you want it easier, this is not easier.
Well, give us some direction on what to do. Because that's what we that was the intent behind it, was to give us some more flexibility for unusual requests of.
And PUDs are a good tool to use for that. So this ordinance is that is if you're starting out from scratch and building a brand new building, or even rehabbing a new one, you have to go through preliminary site plan review, city council review, and then conduct the phasing, and it's not as easy as you might think it is.
When Rebecca sent that, I started reading, and I thought,
this doesn't even seem to go along with that, so I don't know.
Yeah, we need direction.
Well, we'll see if we can get to the bottom of that.
Rebecca, I had a question for you. Renee and I were talking about training, and I remember, I know I've been, and a few people, to, I think it's in like West Olive, mm-hmm. over at the Ottawa County, you know, that do some training. Do you mm-hmm. recall when that is? Yeah, I know they do it like once a year.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen it?
I haven't seen it come back around yet.
Okay.
If I recall correctly, I think it's right after like February.
Okay.
Right in there.
I thought it was more like November or something. I want to make sure that we didn't.
Winter. We know it was winter.
I know.
Yeah,
cool.
I want to thank you guys for the first one day. I got the notification after the election time.
Oh. Okay.
So it's
as soon as I hear anything, I'll make sure to pass it along. Yeah. And then I did send out November training with Mr. Johnson. That's all set. We have several people from the surrounding communities already signed up for that.
Okay.
What was that date again?
I believe it was the 29th.
Could I ask you to make me a copy of the master plan?
A paper copy?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It will be posted to the city's website in an electronic form.
It's okay, I'll let Marion put it.
Yes, and the city to spend the money to print out a copy.
Hey. I print everything at home, and I spend all my time as a volunteer on this board.
Yes, you're a volunteer. You can afford it.
Yes. Hi.
Just give her a hard time.
See what I get all afternoon?
Planning commission members, any comments? Let's start down there.
Oh, I looked at the K&A painting, commercial painting building. It's really looking nice. And the hair salon.
Oh, Nikki.
They do have the garage door or whatever.
They were reminded that they have to follow the site plan.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you heard anything about fixing the cave behind Jeff Pizza? Have you seen anything?
I think the parking, didn't they come to this body for a
yeah.
site plan on that?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. I haven't seen anything, any work or anything.
Yeah, no, I haven't either. I drove past it the other day. I haven't seen anything.
Because didn't they do something with their property line and everything else also?
Yeah,
they put down some gravel or whatever it is.
Yeah, well, that is the thing in the middle.
Isn't it? Yeah. They're mowing further over there.
And then the second one, I just was curious. I was kind of across from Save-A-Lot. They kind of leveled some ground in there. I wonder what. Something's going on there?
Oh, yeah, that was actually the city working with the Brook. They were running the water pipe underneath the road there, and the city requested they upgrade it from an 8-inch to a 12-inch.
Was that city property right there?
No, I think they have an easement across that piece of property to run their water line, because they ended up having to put in a private sewer. But they were doing the city a favor in upgrading the water line.
I do believe this is my last meeting with you guys. I see it's up to here and October's the last meeting, right?
I don't think October's the last meeting. In December.
Election before? I thought you were. Seats over in November.
Generally, the seats are reissued in a December meeting of the council.
Oh, I thought it was the same as the council. Yeah.
Generally,
we got one more.
We got one more.
We're scared them away.
And next month, we're on the second Tuesday, right? Because of
the election next.
Okay.
Because I don't want to start with the mayor. He was talking about November, too.
Mm-hmm.
If I didn't get here in time, you know that I see that the minutes show that I asked to step down. I didn't ask to step down. I asked to not be reappointed. There's a difference, especially if somebody looks at it later.
I'm glad we're all free speechers and that everybody has common sense enough to stand up for the police.
Yeah.
council representative, that's you. You got any updates?
Well, as they were talking about the name going across the last city council, remember, that was something that came up out of the blue, but it, what was it, 14 or 17,000?
I don't think we had a set dollar amount.
Well, anyway, in the long run, it saves us a lot of money.
Yeah, I think it was more on the order of 5 to 10, and it was going to save roughly 50,000 in the future.
Small numbers saving big numbers. We voted to agree to that.
Thank you.
And we had his the city manager's review, and we agreed to keep him on a little bit longer.
I'm still here suffering with you guys.
Other than that, I can't really remember much else.
Mr. Johnson, you got anything else for us?
Well, just procedurally, when you have public hearings like we did on the Culver's tonight, we had me speak first and give you kind of a short introduction of the project, and then go over my report. I wonder, for the benefit of the audience, if it would be better if the applicant presented their project as to what they were doing, the background, the number of parking spaces, what it's all about, so the public is more informed of the project. And then I could give my, you know, critique of it, if you will. And sometimes the applicant will say, we'll give you a summary of the project, and then they'll say, and here's how I address the planner's report. Now, you can then stop them at that point in time and let me speak, but just for the benefit of the audience, I just throw that out for your consideration if you want to change that procedure or at least think about that.
Good work, everybody. So, motion to adjourn?
So,
second. All in favor, aye?
Aye.